God bless you this morning. So good to see your faces with us this morning. I don't know about you, but I was just enjoying the song that Judith is playing. Jesus, there's just something about that name. Kings and kingdoms shall all pass away, but there's something about the name of Jesus. We praise God for you being here this morning, and we want to certainly say welcome to you and welcome to those who may be looking in on us online. We're so glad to have you with us this morning also. And we ask that you go ahead and press the share button, if you will. We want this message, the message of Jesus Christ, to go out through all the land. Amen. I have a scripture I just want to share with you briefly this morning, and it's from the book of Psalms, the 11th number. And it reads this way: In the Lord I take refuge. How then can you say to me, flee like a bird to your mountain? For look, the wicked bend their bows. They set their arrows against the strings to shoot from the shadows at the upright in heart. When the foundations are being destroyed, what can the righteous do? The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord is on his heavenly throne. He observes everyone on earth. His eyes examines them. The Lord examines the righteous, but the wicked, those who love violence, he hates with a passion. On the wicked, he will rain fiery coals and burning sulfur. A scorching wind will be their lot. For the Lord is righteous. He loves justice. The upright will see his face. Folks, that 11th number of Psalm simply says there's a lot going on with the wickedness of this world today. And you hear it and read about it every day. But I declare to you this morning, by the 11th number of Psalm, God is clearly in control. You don't have to worry about anything. God is in control. Let's pray over our meeting this morning. Father God, we love you. We praise your name. We bless you, dear Lord. You are a wonderful Savior. You are a mighty God, Lord. We marvel in your sovereignty, dear Lord. We don't even know or understand, oh Heavenly Father, Lord, the depths of your greatness, oh Heavenly Father. We just clearly put ourselves into your good hands, dear Lord. We bless your name today. We give you glory. Prepare us now, Heavenly Father, to worship you. Let us lay aside all weights that so easily beset us, dear Lord. We want to give you praise. We come before you, dear Lord, humbly, Lord, saying you are God and you are God alone, Lord. Bless, O Heavenly Father, John, and as he leads us in worship, O Heavenly Father, let us, O Lord, sing out your praise. Bless Judy this morning on the piano, dear Lord. Let her play until heaven gets the news, dear Lord. Bless John and Larry, dear Lord, as they just come, stand before us and declare your musical greatness, O Heavenly Father, to heaven, dear Lord. And bless Pastor Rob this morning, dear Lord, as he brings the word. Lord, speak for him. Let your Holy Spirit blow through him. Yes, give us the words that you have us to hear, dear Lord. And not only let us be hearers of your word, Lord, but bless us this morning to be doers of your word. Bless all that look in on this service this morning, Lord. Touch, Lord. Let your healing hand, your hand of mercy, your loving hand, Lord, be our refuge today. In Jesus' name we pray. Together the church said, amen. God bless you,
Lord. John. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Reflecting on that psalm that Michael just read, the name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run into it, and they are saved. Amen. Let's stand and sing that this morning. Go ahead, Judah.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High.
Sing it again.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into, they are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower.
Oh, I'm sorry. Let's do that fast, like you always play it.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into, they are saved. The Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into, they are saved. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into, are saved. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into, and they are saved. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord Most High.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, think I've lost my way, still you're there beside me. Nothing will I fear, long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide. Hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Now I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide. Hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path, and a light unto my path. You're the light unto my path. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts,
Let us not lift our soul to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our soul to another. We bow our hearts, we bend our knees, oh Lord, we turn our eyes from evil things. Oh Lord, we cast down our idols. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our soul to another. Give us clean hands and give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our soul to another. God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, O God of Jacob. God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, O God of Jacob. We bow our hearts, we bend our knees, O Spirit, come make us humble. We turn our eyes from evil things, O Lord, we cast down our idols. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our soul to another. Give us clean hands, give us pure hearts. Let us not lift our soul to another. God, let us be generation that seeks your face, O God of Jacob. God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, O God of Jacob. Glory
to your name. Let's give the Lord the glory due his name.
Thou art worthy, thou art worthy, thou art worthy. They are are created. Thou art worthy, O Lord. Thou art worthy, O Lord.
Lord, you are worthy. You're worthy of all praise, Lord. You're worthy to receive blessing and honor and glory and power and dominion. For there is none like you, O God. There is none like you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise your name, Jesus. There's none like you, Lord. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise your name, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. This is Scripture. Revelations 4:10 and 11 says, the 24 elders fall down before him that sat on the throne and worship him that liveth forever and ever and cast their crowns before the throne, saying, Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for Thou hast created all things. And for thy pleasure, they are and were created. Thou art worthy. Thou art worthy. Thou art worthy, O Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Our God is worthy, isn't he? Whew. Created all things. So we're going to bring to the Lord who created all things our needs right now today. I have Linda Casselli is double pneumonia and COVID kidney failure. She's dehydrated and in the hospital on oxygen. Ron Crosby has been sick with a really bad cold, so pray that he recovers quickly. Eileen Dunkley is in terrible pain from osteoporosis and shingles pain. She's asking for the Lord to call her home. Tony Penna is having surgery on his liver that is not functioning. His wife and caretaker Janice needs prayer as Tony goes through this difficult time. I have a couple of prayer requests for Maurice Graves. Is still hospitalized with cellulitis, and as of today, he has sepsis, and the doctors are running an MRI today to make sure it isn't affecting other areas. So they're asking for continued prayer. Virginia Mertz is having a mastectomy on February 21st due to cancer. Shirley Dvorak will be having a lumpectomy on March 2nd due to breast cancer. And pray for Sister Eva, who her husband is getting very difficult to care for with dementia, and they're looking at options and possibilities, what to do for him. Harold Williams has stage 5 kidney disease and still awaits results from lymph node biopsies. His pneumonia has cleared up, though, and his wife Patricia said because of the prayers of the saints, his congestive heart failure is gone. So that's a praise report. We want to also keep in prayer the students from Parkway Christian School who left for a mission trip on Tuesday to Nicaragua. They're going to be there for the week. And we also want to remember, of course, the students at the Michigan and faculty and all at the Michigan State University campus for all they're going through. And you know what, really? We need to pray for our nation, don't we? We want to pray for God to bring peace and comfort for those who have suffered loss at MSU. But also what often happens is we get a lot of anxiety along through all students and schools, and we want to pray for that. And I don't know if you've heard about this going on, and I would say it's the answer. It's the move of the Holy Spirit. And Asbury College, I don't know if you've heard of this, over the last week has been having an incredible revival for the students that just came out of a routine Wednesday morning chapel. And they have been having 24-hour services there for the past week, and because people are now hearing about this, and because of social media, they're coming to there and then taking that around back to their own universities and colleges. And wouldn't it be wonderful if that's how God moves, through starting with college students and the young people of this country, spreading it from one place to another. So we want to pray for that, because that's the solution. That's the move of the Lord on these campuses. And it's not going to be anything that man ever does. It's something that God does. And we want to pray for the move of the Holy Spirit throughout our country. But let's tune in to see what's going on in our universities and see how he can shine a light in a very, very dark place. So let's pray. And if you have a need as well, raise them to the Lord. Dear God, we are a needy people. And so often we don't even know we need you. Our universities and colleges are filled with students and faculty that know you, that they don't know you, and some refuse to want to know you. But Lord, we know that they all need you. We need you. And we pray, and as we lift up each of these requests to you, we want to ask that you move in your own perfect way, in your own perfect timing. Have your way. Have your way in each of these people's lives that I've named their names, and everything that's every need that's represented by a raised hand, and the needs that we have both at the Michigan State University campus and throughout our country, Lord, we need you. And we pray that you move on the hearts of your people, turn our hearts toward you, and even take care of our physical and emotional, financial, relational needs. Help us, Lord God. Help us. All we can do is cry out to you and ask for your help. We pray that you move in our hearts and our lives as we have a humble heart toward you to stand before you. It's all we can do sometimes, but Lord, you've called for people to intercede even for our country and even for a nation. We're doing that right now. We're asking for healing. Healing, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. A few announcements I have today, too. We want to remind you that Monday is Forgotten Harvest, so if you'd like to help with that, you could let Pastor Barry know about that, that you would like to be there, and that's handing out food to those in need right here in the parking lot, right behind me, really. It's done every other Monday, the first and the third Monday of the month. Also, the Man Up Conference at Cornerstone Church in Highland, that is happening March 3rd through 4th. And also, the men's meeting is this evening. So if you'd like to go to the men's meeting, that's tonight. We'll be meeting in the dining room. And Grief Share starts March 1st. I want to let you know about that. So if you know of somebody, or if you are in need of just kind of walking alongside with somebody, going through some grief that you've gone through, that you've experienced, that class is a great experience that would help you through that. And also, the student retreat, we want to have you keep this in prayer. The students are heading to Mayo, Michigan on March 10th and 12th through the 12th. So that is going to be happening. Pastor Noah will be taking a group of students, high schoolers, middle schoolers there. So we want to ask you for a prayer for that. So keep that in prayer as well. So we're now going to be blessed. Special music with John and Larry Jones.
I do hope you don't mind if I wear my jacket. Ever since I lost my hair last year, I seem to be getting colder.
Are you ready?
Love you, Lord. Oh, your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God.
I love you, Lord. Your mercy never fails me. All my day I've been held in your hand. The moment that I wake up till I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, I will sing of the goodness of God. I love your voice. You have led me through the fire. In darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father. I've known you as a friend. I have walked in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able,
I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good.
With every breath that I am able,
I will sing of the goodness of God.
Your goodness is running after me. Your goodness is running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after me. Your goodness is running after me. Your goodness is running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Your goodness is running after me.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so good.
With every breath that I am able,
I will sing of the goodness of God. I will sing of the goodness of God.
Thank you, John.
Psalm 23 says, surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life. And how does that end? And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you, John and Larry. All right, today is a sort of Valentine's Day plus two, because that was 2 days ago. But we're talking about love. Is that okay? We talk about love today, kind of inspired by Valentine's Day. Nothing to do with St. Valentine, just the subject matter for today. So, it's interesting. I'm going to be reading from the book of 1 John. And 1 John was written to a group of people, maybe, possibly in the area of Ephesus, to a bunch of some churches that John was sort of overseeing, and he was writing to them to encourage them and to stay on track with the original teachings of Jesus and not to be pulled away by false teachings and teachings that may have begun from people who have left the church and they're sort of spouting off their own ideas of who Jesus was, that he's not the Messiah, or he wasn't the King of Kings, and various other, you know, discrepancies. But John is saying to them, stay firm in your faith. And he, in a way, did it in a sort of, like, loopy way and came back in a way of contrasting things that had to do with light and darkness, love and hate, righteousness and sin. And he came looping, he kept looping back to these themes throughout the book of 1 John. And he wanted to make sure that his readers were solidly familiar with the fact that who God was and who Jesus was and how much they loved him, how much God loves us, and how much he cares and who God was and such. So that's kind of a little bit of a background for John, 1 John. But I want to read, starting in chapter 2, verse 28, and I'm going to read from the NIV. So if you want to read along, the Bibles are in the pews in front of you. We're going to start at verse 28, and I'm going to read the chapter of chapter 3, because I think it's important that we see it all in one section. So if you don't, you can just listen, and I will read it. "And now, dear children, continue in him, so that when he appears, we may be confident and unashamed before him at his coming. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who does what is right has been born of him. See what great love the Father has lavished on us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Dear friends, now we are children of God, and what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when Christ appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. All who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Everyone who sins breaks the law. In fact, sin is lawlessness. But you know that he appeared so that he might take away our sins. In him is no sin. No one who lives in him keeps on sinning. No one who continues to sin has either seen him nor known him. Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. The one who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The one who does what is sinful is of the devil, because the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the devil's work. No one who is born of God will continue to sin, because God's seed remains in them. They cannot go on sinning, because they have been born of God. This is how we know who the children of God are and who the children of the devil are. Anyone who does not do what is right is not God's child, nor is anyone who does not love their brother or sister. For this is the message you heard from the beginning. We should love one another." So John is reminding them what Jesus said long ago. This is the message. This is nothing new. This is just repeating what Jesus taught a few decades before. "We should love one another. Do not be like Cain, who belonged to the evil one and murdered his brother. And why did he murder him? Because his own actions were evil and his brother's were righteous. Do not be surprised, my brothers and sisters, if the world hates you. We know that we have passed from death to life because we love each other. Anyone who does not love remains in death. Anyone who hates a brother or sister is a murderer. And you know that no murderer has an eternal life residing in him. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother and sister in need, but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with actions and in truth. This is how we know that we belong to the truth and how we set in our hearts at rest in his presence. If our hearts condemn us, we know that God is greater than our hearts, and he knows everything. Dear friends, if our hearts do not condemn us, we have confidence before God and receive from him anything we ask because we keep his commands and do what pleases him. And this is his command, to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love one another as he commanded us. The one who keeps God's commands lives in him and he in them, and this is how we know that he lives in us. We know it by the Spirit he gave us. Dear Lord God, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for inspiring John to write these words down to tell us about who you are, who we are in you, and the difference between us and those who don't follow you. Help us have our minds and hearts trained on you in everything we do, in Jesus' name, amen. So, what I'm wanting to do now is to break down a little bit and kind of, not verse by verse, but section by section to make sure we get some of the important things to take away from the book of, from this chapter of 1 John chapter 3. So I think one of the first things that's important that he's bringing to point and us to take into account is that we need to, as if we're going to be children of God, God's children, we need to be unashamed of his return, right? So think of that. If we knew someone was coming, we would need to be prepared. Someone important, I think I talked about this last month, we knew someone important was coming, we would be prepared. So it's important for us to be prepared and unashamed when Jesus someday does return. So whatever we're doing, we want to make sure that at whatever moment he knocks on the door and says, I'm here, we're ready and be unashamed. So it's important that our life needs to reflect that. One thing that helps us do that, though, is to recognize the greatness of God's love and how he adopted us into his family. It's really interesting, the word that is, when it speaks of how great, in verse 1 of chapter 3, see what great love the Father. That word in Greek points to an idea like it's something from far away, something from another country, almost exotic. Like this is something that we've never seen before. This kind of love, you see, it's this idea. So John is bringing this idea that this kind of love is something that we haven't ever seen before. Why? Because it's coming from God. And this is the kind of love that it's important for us to recognize and take hold of, and then see what he's done with this love. What has God done? He's lavished it on us. He's poured it on us. He's given it to us generously. Think of that. He's given us this exotic love immeasurably. And this is what's important for us to see. Now we start to see, wow, this is the kind of God we have. And not only does he love us, because, you know, we talk about this word love a lot. Valentine's Day, send a box of chocolates, you know, love, I love you. But the interesting thing is we say I love you a lot, right? But the word love is a verb. It's an action. It's something you do, not something you say. Love isn't a feeling. It's an action. But we so often use it as a feeling. And the world for sure uses it as a feeling. But it's not a feeling. If you love somebody, you're going to do things for them. You're going to spend time with them. You're going to give them a hug. You're going to give gifts. You're going to do things to show them that you love them. And this is, and how do we know how much God loves us? Well, one way we know is in this very same sentence is that we're called children of God. Now, how can that be? Like, if only that he adopted us into his family. You know, the Jews, they saw themselves as children of God, but Gentiles didn't. But now we've been brought into God's family. He's like little orphan Annie. She was hopeless. She was living in the orphanage under Miss Hannigan. And Daddy Warbucks comes along and changes everything for her. Yes, materially, but how much more loving is our God who has changed our lives eternally, right? And he's brought us into a family that now, you know, in some other areas it speaks of in the Bible that we're not just children, but we're like heirs to what God owns. And we are heirs to the Father and co-heirs with Jesus. That's what we have ahead of us because we're adopted into his family. We get all the privileges of being a family member, just as Jesus spoke about. Something else that it's important for us to catch up is in verse 3, purity. And our importance that we stay pure, and how are we supposed to do it? By keeping our hope in God. And as we keep our hope in God, it says right here, it's not my words, all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. So as we put our hope in Jesus, that has cleansing power. That's just like how Jesus is pure and clean. So something else that's important for us to see is that Christ appeared to take away our sins. That's why he came. And there's this interesting change. Like it's talking about love and how much God loves us. Starting in chapter 3, but then in verse 4, all of a sudden we hear about sin. Everyone who sinned, it's talking about how much love God's given us. And then verse 4, it says, everyone who sins breaks the law. It's like, whoa, what's that? Why do we need to talk about sin? Let's talk about love. And you know, unfortunately, I think that's a lot what the world likes to do. The world likes to talk about sort of the good things, but it's also the selfish things, the stuff that benefits ultimately themselves, because the world's love is a selfish love. And as I go down this list of takeaways, we're going to focus on what the God kind of love is. But the world's love is selfish, and that's not love. So it's important for us to understand when we're getting a message from the world, when it comes to love and sort of the solution for the problems of the world, that the world only has what we can think of in our brain, it always falls short. It can only go so far because it's all self-serving. Why do we need to sort of save the planet? Because we want to have a great place for us to live. We want to have clean air. When we really should save the planet because it's been given to us to be stewards of. That's why that's why we don't litter. That's why we don't allow people, a big industry to pour pollution into the river, because that's not caring for the earth. Not because we want to have a wonderful place for us. We want clean drinking water, but the point is it's not selfish. We're thinking, because we're taking care of this place that is not ours. It's God's. So then, but when you hear that, then there's a different motivation for doing things that the world tries to find a solution for, but the real solution is because of God. So it helps to have our hearts tuned in the right way. So, as I was saying about Christ, he appeared to take away our sins, and I said, chapter 4, verse 4, is this feels like a sort of a whiplash, but it really isn't, because the verse previous talking about purity and being clean. So when you talk about clean, we also need to talk about being dirty. And how does that happen? It happens because of sin. But the solution to being dirty is Jesus. And the takeaway for that idea and this next section about talking about sin is that Jesus came to take away our sin. And if we're in Him, then we're going to have a different view of sin. The world tries to make distinctions between right and wrong, and we have laws, and we try and, you know, create order for society. But when it comes to doing what's right and wrong, we as Jesus followers are called to look here and look to Him for our example, for doing what's right, for knowing what is wrong and evil, and then what we need to do because about it. If we discover that we are dirty within us, we need to be cleansed, we take it before the Lord. If we realize that things are going on in our society, in our, you know, neighborhood, or in our home, it's time for us to deal with it, bring it before the Lord, ask for forgiveness, and ask Him to clean us. Ask Him to clean out what's bringing us down. We have a different view of sin. And yes, we always will be dealing with the little things that bother us throughout our life. We wouldn't be singing the songs like we were earlier about how our hearts wander sometimes, and it's important for us to pull back. Why? Because we live in a dirty, messed up world that's broken. And it's going to be broken until Jesus comes back. So we have to cope, and the way we cope is looking to Jesus and calling on Him. And when we do stumble, we don't go deeper into that mess. We pull ourselves out and we say, or we call out to Jesus by asking Him to cleanse us, to pick us up, to put us back together. Another takeaway would come from verse 7, and that's where I was kind of leading to next, is that we're not to be led astray, and to stay on the path. Like I said before, as we talked about when it came to what sort of one of John's motivations for writing this to the original readers was that they were hearing false teaching, and he wanted them to not be led astray, so he brought them back to the truths, the original teachings that Jesus said from His own mouth, that they needed to remain faithful to those beliefs and teachings all the way to the end. So it's important for us to do that too. It's important for us to focus back on what is Jesus teaching us and making sure that we're lining up with that. And as I've already kind of mentioned a little bit, and originally mentioned in the beginning, John's point is to try and bring these contrasts. But something else that it comes from, you know, even verse 11 and talking about, there's a huge, huge difference between the children of God and the children of the devil. And where it's important that we stay aligned with what God teaches, as I've said already. So then in verse 11, like I said before, Jesus is saying, John is pointing back to the original teaching, for this is the message you heard from the beginning. We should love one another, not like Cain. And it's, you know, it's so interesting how it goes, so often it goes back to Cain, because that's where that original, you know, the original sin was Adam and Eve, but the original sort of manifestation is like, whoa, things have really gotten bad, is a murder of your own brother, and that's bad. And so they went from perfection, a garden of perfection, to now we live in this world where people kill each other. And that's a sorry state of affairs. And John is pointing this huge contrast out. Like, this is not how you're to live. And he talks a little bit more about that. Like, that's a pretty major offense, murder. So I think that's a clear contrast. And though, you know, hopefully none of us have murdered someone here, the point is that we don't want to be, he's pointing to the importance of the importance of recognizing that Cain was a child of the devil. And not that he came from the devil, but the sin that motivated Cain was from the devil. But contrasting with that is the seed that's planted in us as children of God comes from Jesus. So he's saying, don't be like Cain, instead, be like Jesus. And then, so what's like Jesus mean? So in case you weren't sure, John goes right into it. This is how we know what love is. Jesus Christ laid his life down for us. And he's writing us. He's talking about for you, the reader, and for himself. All of us. He laid his life down for us. That's how we know what love is. Now, we may not have the opportunity to lay our lives down for someone else, which John says, and Jesus even said, that there's no greater love than that. So how can we show love to the people around us? Well, John answers that question right away, and this is how he does it. We ought to lay our lives down for our brothers and sisters. Okay, like I said, we don't always have that opportunity, but often it's a state of mind, too. It's self-sacrifice. It's like I was saying before, the love of the world is selfish, but the love from God is selfless, so that not even your own life is valuable enough, has enough value, that you are willing to offer that to save another. See, that's what Jesus did. He offered his life to save another, the whole world. And this is the idea, that the love that we have has to be sort of with that insight, that our love has to be a self-sacrificing type of love. So sometimes a way to do it is we have to sometimes offer up something of our own. Maybe not our lives, but our stuff, because it's not technically ours anyway. So and this is what John then points to. He says, if anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need, but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? Dear children, let us not love with words or speech, but with action and in truth. Here is sort of my pivoting point for today. And we're going to pull it out of a different translation. But John talked about, he offers the example of, if you see somebody in need, help them. And that is a way we show love. If anyone has material possessions and sees a brother or sister in need, but has no pity on them, how can the love of God be in that person? He gives that example. He doesn't say, go give money to the poor. He uses this idea that if you don't, then you don't have God's love in you. I'm going to read this next verse, verse 18. I'm going to put it up on the screen in a different version. The Voice, and this is from the Voice translation. It's from, and this is kind of what inspired me for today's subject. Here's how it goes. My little children, don't just talk about love as an idea or a theory. Make it your true way of life and live in the pattern of gracious love. We'll just leave that up for a minute. It's what the NIV says. It's just a slightly different translation, but it's what John is saying. Love, we're not supposed to love like it's something, a theory or an idea. You're supposed to put your love into action. Make it your true way of life. It's how you live in a loving way. It's how it's one of the important aspects of who God is. God is love. And he does everything from out of that love, from his holiness and from his love. Everything he does comes from that. I'm going to read a series of scriptures, just one after the other, of what was said to be done when it comes to showing love. This is what Jesus said. This is three from Jesus in Matthew 5:16. Let your good deeds shine out for all to see, so that everyone will praise your heavenly Father. Matthew 6, 3 and 4. But when you give to someone, don't tell your left hand what your right hand is doing. Give gifts in secret, and your Father, who knows all secrets, will reward you. In Matthew 6, 19, 21, don't store up treasures here on earth. Store your treasures in heaven. Wherever your treasure is, there your heart and your thoughts will also be. Here's what Paul said, 1 Timothy. For women who claim to be devoted to God should make themselves attractive by the good things they do. 1 Timothy 6, tell those who are rich to use their money to do good. They should be rich in good works. All scripture is God's way of preparing us in every way, fully equipped for every good thing that God wants us to do. I jumped from two different Timothy points. And in Titus, he says, these things I have told you all are true. I want you to insist on them so that everyone who trusts in God will be careful to do good deeds all the time. These things are good and beneficial for everyone. And here's what James said. Suppose you see a brother or sister who needs food or clothing, but then don't give that person any food or clothing. What good does that do? So you see, it isn't enough just to have faith. Faith that doesn't show itself by good deeds is no faith at all. It is dead and useless. And here's what Peter said. Be careful how you live among your unbelieving neighbors. Even if they accuse you of doing wrong, they will see your honorable behavior. It is God's will that your good lives should silence those who make foolish accusations against you. Those were all from the New Living Translation. It's not all about money. It's about how you connect with the people around you, and that we're to show love. And that's what John said in verse 11. This is what you've been taught for years. Love one another. So, as we pull up to the communion table, you know, it's an opportunity for us to check ourselves and to say, where are we? Ask the Lord through the Holy Spirit just to highlight the things that we can do better at. And I think that's a good, an important sort of exercise to do as much as we can. Communion is just sort of a corporate together opportunity that we can do that at. And so that's what we do now. We just consider what's been said, this idea about what love is, and how we can show it. Maybe there you've been doing that. Maybe you've been able to show your neighbors, your family, the people around you, what love is, and you put it to action. Great. We all can always improve. We always can do better. So let's just quietly sit before the Lord and ask Him to help us to do better, whether that's improving or taking that first step of love towards family or our neighbors or the people around us, whoever needs that. And whoever we need to show love to. So let's just quietly, just for a minute or so, let's think about that. Dear God, we thank You for Your love and the love that You lavished upon us. And You showed how much it really was. You didn't just say it. You showed us how much You love us in an act of self-sacrifice. You offered Your body to be hung on a cross for us. And it's the very least we can do to offer ourselves as living sacrifices, to be part of Your body, to be not just me, but to be part of a family. So we consider ourselves and we consider our walk with You right now and our place in the body, and the sacrifice that You made for us. And we roll it all together and we humbly come before You, seeking to do better, seeking to continue to walk another step of faith with You, the great God who created the universe yet showed tremendous selflessness, all for our benefit. Whew. Thank You. Bless this bread and what it symbolizes, the body of Christ. Thank You for the opportunity to be part of it. In Jesus' name, amen. So the passage I read in 1 John, right at the end of the chapter, this is how it ends. I'm going to read from the Voice translation. Whatever we may ask, we receive it from Him, because we follow His commands and take the path that pleases Him. His command is clear. Believe in the name of His Son, Jesus, the Anointed, and love one another as He commanded. The one who follows his teaching and walks this path lives in an intimate relationship with God. How do we know that he lives in us? By the gift of his Spirit. If we have the Spirit living in us, he's moving. He's growing things about us. The fruit of the Spirit. And what's fruit number one? Love. So we call on the Holy Spirit to work within us so that our proverbial tree will have fruit growing from it that will benefit the people around us. Think of the idea of a fruit tree. The fruit doesn't benefit the tree as much as it benefits the person plucking the fruit off and enjoying the fruit. The tree enjoys it from the sense that, like, if a fruit drops and the seed takes root, there'll be another tree. But the tree doesn't enjoy the fruit. Who enjoys the fruit? The people around us. So if we have the Holy Spirit working inside of us, we have this beautiful fruit growing from us of love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and all the others to benefit the people around us. And it's how we can show love to those around us, by allowing the Holy Spirit to work inside of us and grow. And that's one of those gifts that we get from Jesus, all because of his self-sacrifice. So we want to consider the blood right now. Dear Lord God, thank you for your gift of the blood of Jesus that you that poured out for us to wash away our sins so that we can receive the Holy Spirit, so that we can love others, but ultimately so we can stand before you clean, righteous, and walk with you in an intimate relationship like it says in 1 John. This blood that cleans us, makes us white as snow, we thank you for it. We thank you for the power of your blood. Because if it wasn't for that, we wouldn't be able to stand before you. We wouldn't be able to someday live with you. We're sorry for the mess that we've made. But we accept this gift of eternal life through your Son, Jesus. Great God, I ask that you bless this cup. Help us remember that the power in it. In Jesus' name, amen. The Holy Spirit gives us power to do all sorts of things. He's the comforter. He stays with us. He enlightens us as we read the Word of God. He quickens us to say things when we need to. And he helps us love, even the unlovable. Or so-called unlovable, the people who are sometimes different from us, the people who sometimes drive us crazy, the people who are even our enemies. And that's not my words, those are Jesus. He called us to love our enemies. So, God, we pray that you move in our hearts as we go forward for the rest of this week and through all our days, to help us love one another like you loved us. Help us live a life of self-sacrifice, giving up the things that sometimes are hard to do so. Help us not hold on to the things that we have like they're ours, because they're really not. They're yours. Even our time, even our energy, and the stuff we have, we can offer all of those things in love to the people around us. Help us see them as ways to show love to those people. And we'll do it all in your name, Jesus. Amen. God bless you all. Thank you. The altars are open as usual. Have a great week.